TV, so without further ado, I'd like to welcome to the stage Luke Presley, lead designer. Evan Roberts, global head of development. With us again this year, all the way from Germany, Brian Chambers, Development Director. Send us a lovely video message, but you've managed to make it here in person. So why don't you tell us a bit about who you are and what you do?
Basically my job. my job is basically, I'm the chief development officer for the company, so it's really to work with Chris. So when Chris basically has the vision for the game, my job is then to work for everybody to make sure that vision. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell.
Lovely. Luke Presley, what about you? What does a lead designer do?
I tell other people to do the work. So 2 years ago, when I was like the guy doing the work, I get to think of the same things I was thinking of 2 years ago, but then I had to do that, I had to get into the engine, implement it, test it, check it in, kind of thing. Now I get to sit back, think about that, and then hand it off to another, my team. So,
He's playing himself down as well.
I do a lot more than that, yeah. But it's emails. I didn't want to say, I do emails. I do quite a lot of emails.
And finally, Brian Chambers, tell us a bit about your role in all of this.
I'm the development director for the Frankfurt office, so I basically keep things running for the team. It's anything from just coordinating to make sure the office is actually running. When there's production issues, I pull the team together and we sort it out. If there's higher level stuff that needs to go on, Aaron will give me a call and we'll work across studios to get stuff going. But it's just to make sure that you assist the team at all levels to remove obstacles so we can keep churning along every single day.
So, a quick warm-up question for all of you. What is your favorite bio?
Stuff that's been worked on is coming out, it should be coming out 3.3, and that the level of detail that we're creating for the planets, especially I think my favourite is kind of we've got a great biome sort of which is great. It's just basically it's kind of like if you watch Wall-E, it's that sort of just everything's just devastated and just basically ruined and basically just a big garbage sort of like the planet. So that's a bad couple of favourites so far.
So that's on Ursa. I think that's got about 6 biomes on it. I gotta say the trash biome is also one of my favourites. If anyone's saw Blade Runner this year, last year. When I saw there was a coastal biome, it was up in sea.
sense that working in the Frankfurt, all teams contribute to everything, but seeing some of the procedural tech come up from the engineers and the environment artists on site in Frankfurt helping support and start to create these and then it get handed off globally. It's just really cool to see the diversity and how they change, right? From a technical concept of what is possible and the tool set that enables this, right? And then to see them start being constructed and you get your first one, your second one, and then you go, oh my God, look what they did there. And when you look at the trash one, I think for me too, I gravitated as well because you just go, okay, visually from what we've built so far, you look at that and just, it has that level of detail and the richness and the denseness to it.
On a factory scale. It's on a factory scale, which is amazing. That's the deal. It's not just one little area. It's the level of detail for all the items, on that sort of factory scale is what is truly impressive. Really impressive. Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to say, oh, I like this one the best, because you, in a way, if you look, think of them as your children. This one may be taller and this one may be quicker, but you enjoy them.
No plan survives contact with the enemy, or in this case, development. What have been some of the biggest changes in direction or plan after trying something out? Two-way planet, you can walk around that planet, you can do things on that planet where you can take off, you can go to a space station, however, just in one system alone is just a huge amount of stuff which we wouldn't have had before. That wasn't what the original scope of the game was going to be, and that's changed before we have that. So how do you deal with these changes? How do you make sure your teams are ready for them? Or how do you prepare your teams to...
I mean, I think a lot of it is we have to work at Cloud Imperium Games. You've got to be a certain type of person. You've got to be able to work. We're building a company. I've said it a few times. We're building a company while building technology while building a game at the same time. And to work at Cloud Imperium Games, you've got to be a type of person who's prepared to deal with. I don't call it chaos, but a little bit of just like, a lot of references, you're trying to work out stuff won't work quite as well as you want to. You don't have approved, we have to build systems to get them to work and so forth, and that's what we do over the last few years. And so you need to have, people need to be ready that sometimes they're going to do something that won't work, and then we have to go back and look what it is, we have to fix it, and we have to redo some things to get where we want to go, and we have to go down some dead ends to get where we want to go and so forth. And so basically, that's the biggest one, having those sort of employees, I mean, that are prepared to work with the team and accept that things are not going to work sometimes the way they should be, and they might want to go and design a level, but they can't because there's a problem here that has to get fixed first and so forth. You need that sort of temperament. To
we have to dive straight in. Like, we have to be given that technology, and it won't have been made with the kind of user, like the developer in mind, or the designer, say, in mind. So we just get our heads stuck in, write down all the things that need improvements, work with the guys who made it in the first place to actually get it to that level of turning into a game. We don't work like any other company, obviously, I've worked with, where you get to just hide everything. You know, we wouldn't be making missions at this point in a real game. We'd still be working on technology. So our team especially has to not get precious about, you know, we all the missions we made that were in Flowgraph, you know, they're all in the bin. We had to remake everything when we went to Subsumption. And I'm sure we will again, like when, because we're working on the modularity of the missions right now. So there'll be whole chunks of things we throw away. But it's always like, you know, in that direction of being able to make them faster, make them better. So, yeah, just, we can't be precious, I guess.
Yeah, it was something this ambitious. Every day we're trying something new, and you have to just do that. You have to jump in and try. And we do make very calculated decisions at the same time. When we look at something and we stand back and you go, okay, is this truly scalable to what we need, right? And if you're on the edge and we're not sure, you know, we don't just go, okay, throw it away, let's do something new. It's a calculated process that we go through, and we see what impact it has, and what we can do now with what's available versus what code needs to be written with what we want out of releases. And so we have to line it all up. But it's, as Aaron said, I completely agree. I mean, the people that are being superstars on the teams we have here are, you know, people that
very agile.
You grab something, the moment if you get married, you can't get married to it, right? Because the moment you get in, if you realize that something needs to tweak, certain people with certain mentalities, that would be incredibly frustrating, right? And even if it is frustrating to us, we just have to go, no, this is the best choice, let's do this.
With the first iteration of mining coming in 3.2, and all the pretty images we saw in this week's ATV, mining is on everyone's mind. Can you speak about what this first iteration of mining is going to be like for us?
Sure. Thanks, Aaron. I guess you've all seen the videos. And so first off, I don't know if you all know, it's just going to be on Binance to start with. You've seen the images change. All the rocks that are around on the planet currently. Like, the great thing about that is that you'll see a rock, and as you get close to it, only at that point do we switch it out for the mineable wet entity. You go into it, use your mining laser, aim at it, fire, keep it within us. You have to have a kind of controlled explosion you want, otherwise you'll end up taking your wing off. If you just fire your laser at it, start like full power because you want to get it done as quick as possible, it's going to blow up and it may damage your ship, especially in space. All the rock pieces of rock flying around. So it's a balance of speed versus the power you put into it. And then after that, once they're in bits small enough to pick up, you'll use your tract beam, pick that up, goes into the canisters until those are filled. You'll go off, sadly right now you'll only go off and sell that kind of mixed ore to, all the places, all the kiosks that you can currently sell it to. But the ones that will buy it, the mining outposts may buy it, I'm not sure, both like Olisar and that. But in future, obviously, you'll take that to a refinery and you'll get all the bits broken down into the individual parts that you'll sell for a lot more money.
The idea is you want to be flexible to there, so you can either mine the ore and you can sell the ore, so you can probably take it to a refinery and sell it, or you basically go to a refinery and you pay money to have it refined. obviously you're taking more risk about it because you are now putting more of your money in to get it refined to take it, and then from there you have to take it to somewhere to sell it, and in between those two locations you maybe get more money because you refined it, but if you get attacked by pirates then you're in more trouble and so forth and things. So we're going to basically have a sort of balance of where you can just extract your own and sell it, and of course it's, you know, it might be, you know, 3% gold and a big chunk of the ore, so you'll get to, you know, the amount of money is going to refine less, or you refine it down and get more money and so forth. And it's more like gameplay. You have to go to places and you make decisions what you want to do, if you hire someone to protect you, you know, what station do you do that, all those kind of things.
Can I just give an example of that? Like, okay, it's mining, but actually being able to you know, fly around a planet and have things, but it's just art at the moment as you're far away, and as you get closer it turns into an actual really complex entity. That was built for mining. Obviously that works for scavenge, the junkyard we were talking about. You get next to any of those bits of metal, it'll turn into something that you can actually scavenge. But you go up to a tree, it's a bit of art, but as you get closer, it actually turns into an entity with item ports, and each of those item ports has fruit on it that you can pick, you know. It may sound like, we've just done mining, but actually this is, opens up like the gate.
And again, that's building things then, so they're scalable for the application.
I mean, that's what a lot of, you know, the work in the last few years has gone into, is create these systems. So when we actually do something like we're saying now, mining, all of a sudden it can be applied across to lots of other things very quickly. And so that's how terms of money moved from mining to get something like salvage. You know, so all of a sudden we have systems in place, so that becomes a lot faster to do, and get the systems in place working for the same stuff. I mean, the biggest issue we typically have, because we have a lot of systems in place in the game, is the user interface and the user experience, how we get that to the player and so forth. And so one thing we're also working on is how we can get our turnaround on the sort of user interface sort of faster, because we have a lot of times where the problem is it's a large process for us to get the ability, all this great codes underneath, to actually expose it to you guys, you can use it. It's always our biggest hurdle, every time we get to a drop, it always comes down to, okay, we have to, that's a level, that's one of the other things, obviously, we're going to be investing as well. Just completely changing the topic.
That's true.
What upcoming gameplay element are you most excited for players to get their hands on?
I personally, this is a prime example of what I'm talking about here, and I've talked about the fact that we're exposing this to you guys. So we have item, you know, we have the item 2.0 stuff, and that's all about the ability. So, you know, everything from obviously weapons and items, stuff, but say on your ship, one of the big things for me is having players actually working properly on a ship together, and that's one of the big pushes that I'm pushing for right now in terms of this year is working towards getting that kind of stuff. So everything from stuff like turrets working well and properly, so you have fun with your friends and all that kind of stuff, to be able to join with your friends and have experience of how you get together in terms of the quantum linking you're seeing, so your ability, so when you're together, you can jump together, so if you get interdicted, you are together, so called ability, if you get tactical and your friends, all this kind of stuff, and then on board a ship also, the item side, having the ability on a ship that you can upgrade your ship well, and it makes a difference. If you buy a certain item, which is a cheaper item, it may give you some boost, but it may be unreliable, may break down, and you might get a more reliable item, which does give you, you know, because you better stuff all the way through, because we have to get wearing to them, and then we've got to get the whole thing. The idea that players are managing their ships, and the ships become precious to players, it's really important that, for Star Citizen, it's not going to work if people just use ships as throwaway items. It's got to be something that they invest in, and you know, like you would do like a car, you wouldn't just go smash the car and I'll get another one, it just doesn't work that way. And so, and the same thing with your ships, and so once we get these items working, you can play with your friends, and you can swap stuff in and out, you know, if you're under attack, you get attacked, and your system's going down, and you have to send people to areas to fix stuff up and get it back up and running, you know, Star Trek style, before, you know, the shields come down, that kind of stuff. That's the stuff, for me, which is going to be really exciting, is getting that combined player experience, and that's actually, when we had the survey went out before, and one of the reasons for it's all over the place here now, when the survey went out before, we, you know, one of the things we'd get across is we have all these systems which are kind of working, but they're not working as well. And so we want to invest in that, so all that stuff that is caught sort of there, get it really working well, so you've got this great experience to be able to come to upgrade your shit, to work with your friends, or, you know, that kind of level of things. That is what we want to do, you know, going forward. And at the same time, we'll put in new features like mining, like salvage and so forth, things. But going back, this year's session for me is about bringing all that to life. Because if we just get that working in Star Citizen, you know, then we've got this incredible just sandbox game for experience that everyone can play together. You know, and then we just let the logic of 10 streaming, which is going to make such a huge difference. Then we just layer in all this content that people can explore and do things with. It's going to make massive, massive you know, difference to everybody.
And so, obviously, ditto, pretty much covered it there. Plus, like, being able to play missions together. I'm a big co-op and multiplayer fan. Like, being able to play missions together as well as the, you know, you take a crew of a ship, fix it up, all that, but you've got to have something to do on the other side. Like, so, that, especially. I'd say scanning, for me, is really cool as well. It's gonna, because we make missions, so the ability not to just put objective marker on something, like leave the player by the nose constantly, but put them in an area and say, you know, he went missing here, please find it. That's quite interesting to me. And object container streaming, because at the moment, like I say, we've got these three movements in there, like that's a pretty impressive feat, like, because they're all loaded at the same time. But it would get to the point where I'm struggling to add more content because, you know, frame rate, all this. So we're kind of held back right now. So the moment, you know, that's in, we'll be unleashed, basically. Yeah, so I'm looking forward to that. I'd say, well, technically, the most.
And then also, just like the other thing is, once we start putting actual AI into the game, to include the universe with the players as well, that'll be really cool. Wait for you, maybe you have to do an assassination, maybe you have to, you know, maybe reinforcements turn up, all that kind of stuff. So that's one of the things that we want to push ahead with this year as well, to get that in there. On bases, rather than just have like a green zone, you know, there should be some security there, there should be security in these tracks, shooting people, the security can map you and kill you. So that kind of stuff, so that's sort of the real life thing as well.
Just use that extra layer of immersion, right?
Have you seen a shift from tool creation to content creation over the past months?
We have, no. We've been doing it all at the same time. So we're creating a huge amount of content, and we've been creating a bunch of tools. But in fact, right now we're heading with what Luke was talking about. Now we're double down investing in more tool creation to help, because the problem is, you've got to get the tech in place to get the tools in place. So right now we're investing heavily on doing what Luke's talking about. It's now creating, making it easier for our developers to use the tools we have and so forth. We have a huge list of stuff, and we'll be working on it for a long time, I'm sure. You know, we'll still be creating more tools when we're in Spectrum 2 and 3 and so forth. But the thing is, basically, we're just all waiting to define and making that process better and trying to fix that stuff. You just have to. You have to. That process never ends in terms of just creating it. But now, at the moment, we have a huge amount of content. We've got a lot of tool stuff going on. Our pipelines are certainly so much better now than they were, you know, 2 years ago. And it'll be better again in another year's time. But you're just always improving that stuff to make it better. Obviously, one of the end goals, you know, which is one of the things we talked about, is one of the end goals, obviously, won't be for a while, is to be able to put some of these tools in the hands of you know, you guys as well. That's one of our stated goals to do then. So, I guarantee you right now you guys would be like going, oh god, so we need to get it to a stage where it is that sort of user friendly stuff to do that, and that's our job and our side for that stuff done. So
no new tool ever comes in like usable from day one. Everything we like inherited from CryEngine and Unreal kind of thing is that's years and years of work on top of that already. So it's one of those things. Like if you imagine you
Code will go away and create something to make that happen. It doesn't mean that make it happen is a nice way for the designers to use it. And so then you go back and say, right, now we can do this, but we need a more effective way of doing this, and then go back and modify the tools. And right now, for example, right now, we have a lot of different editors in lots of different places, and it's actually trying right now to get it all in one place, so designers have to open up finding different things in one go to do it. There's a lot of work we do all the time, but you know, we go away with this assumption, as long as for them, so forth, so we're driving that to bring all it together and make it more cohesive for the team.
But the tools we've created over the last couple of years though, have definitely increased our efficiency, creating content and implementing things. But as Igor said, I mean, tools will always grow and always mature. And we're not settling for like, oh, this tool's a little hacky, but if it works, she knows the ins and outs, right? It may get the job done, but we want to make it as clean and as direct and as bug free for internal processes, so ultimately we can be you guys.
We have a tools group of probably about 5 or 6 guys, probably. We have a huge backlog of stuff we want to work through, and they just keep on working through it. They're like, well, it's a high priority, and you just keep going through that.
And really, the approach changes too. I mean, there's a whole roadmap for them, but it might be cinematics tools versus AI tools versus design tools. That is an honest thing in production as well. I mean, it's, you know, hey, everybody wants their tools across all disciplines, but we don't have 45 engineers sitting there writing tools. There's a certain amount of resources, so some people have to suck it up and wait a little bit longer and still work in a certain way, while other people get the newer, prettier stuff.
Yes.
Yeah, usually cinematics, because they'll he makes the eye candy, so when he says, hey, I need this, and it's going to make it look, you know, that much better, and he shows us examples, we go, yeah, duh, of course you need that. But it's also probably good. We've actually, so far, when you think of the makeup of the team, we've actually edited tools artists with the cinematics team, and they primarily, and will for quite a while, just focus on tools that are needed for cinematics.
Can you tell us a little bit about some of the tools we haven't seen yet?
I mean, there's a lot. I mean, it kind of ranges anything, right? For me, it's always a concept, and you guys will probably break down more, but it's a concept if an animator, an artist, a lighting artist, a VFX artist, whoever, if there's something that they need to do multiple times and multiple clicks, or have multiple things combined together, and it's a routine process. To be able to create a user interface that allows them to take those repetitive tasks and to increase efficiency by putting things together. And the other side of it is you say, well, this technically doesn't really work with, this technical makeup doesn't work with this technical one. So then the tool in the middle helps those two merge together to spit out something new. And for me, it really crosses across the whole board of just about every discipline.
Yeah, tools
are boring.
They kind of are.
Yeah, I mean, you've seen some assumption, you know, and you probably want to comprehend what it's capable of, but that's hard to show in screenshots and videos, so there's just linking things together. DataForge, powerful, but it's not exciting.
So yes, there are probably tools we haven't mentioned, but it's not like, oh, let me tell you about this tool.
Yeah.
Right? There's nothing really, no emphasis behind it.
It's what it creates, right?
No, but we've talked about that. And that's, again, when you talk about tools, so, you know, the tool for, the planetary tool that the artists have, I mean, we would not be able to populate planets to level the density in a time frame that makes any sense without this tool,
right?
So there's some tools that just go, oh, cool, this will make your life easier. And there's other tools where we still know, in order to us to achieve our goals, we absolutely need that. And you look at like the procedural, that planetary tool, absolutely. It's a 100% necessity in order to get it done to the level of detail that we want.
Erin, there's a specific question for you.
Uh-oh.
idea how far into pre-production on Squadron 42 episodes 2 and 3 has gone, if at all, with regards to story specifically, and will there be choices in episode 1 that will carry over?
Sorry, that's the last part of the question.
Will there be story choices from episode 1 that will carry over into episodes 2 and 3?
So yes to that part. Episodes 1, 2 and 3 are just it's one big epic story which is broken into like, 3 different scenarios. In terms of pre-production, we have the story, there is some work on the script, and we are doing obviously a lot of content work in terms of a lot of the stuff we use in Squadron is going to be in Squadron 2 and 3, but we don't actually specifically have designers or anybody working on Squadron 2 and 3 because obviously most of Squadron finish first, so that's what we're focusing on. But yes, there's a lot of stuff, and Squadron once again is an example of you know getting all the tools and all the work together to make that happen, because once you have Squadron finished, you have all the tools there and all the support for that, then actually getting this second 2 episodes out will be much, much faster than much faster. Just to be clear on that, I'm going to have to wait like 5 years for this.
So you're not giving us any details
then? No. But it is, you know, it's the thing about, it's a lot of chemistry to go. Obviously, industry knocks is another big part of Squadron, because it's not consistent, it's got the same issues. It's a single player experience, so it's not as hardcore as the do on the PU side, but there is, you know, there's still a lot of tools work. Getting AI where it used to be and so forth, and that stuff is a big task.
What would be your advice for fledgling game designers for getting into game design?
It's really difficult to give anyone a general kind of thing. If you love making games and you've been doing it since you were a kid, like I didn't go to university to do games design. I went to do special effects, and when I got there I realised it wasn't the kind of special effects I wanted, and kind of rethought and realised, like, I've been making games since I was a kid, you know, on my Amiga and that, so why, you know, I enjoy it, why not do this? So I switched my course to do that. So I think if you love it enough and you're like persistent enough, then, and you can write a decent CV, like it was my CV that got me noticed. I got lucky, so I can't tell you the secret to it.
I think it really depends on what you're doing. So if you are an artist, then that's typically just show some kick-ass art. That's we're one of the industries where still I think where, you know, in some areas you don't need to have a degree or anything like that. You can come in and stuff, and someone comes along for a fantastic portfolio and they show you stuff and they show a lot of enthusiasm for what they're doing, then we'll absolutely look at those people and use them. Design is definitely a harder one, because, you know, how do you know someone's going to be a good designer until you I think once again it's like some enthusiasm, and we do take a lot of times, is there's a lot of people who come off game design courses who just get in by going to QA to start with and just do working through game stuff, and there's a show a lot of promise, then they're basically given an opportunity. We've had people who have come to do work experience with us in terms of from university, and they come and we are, if someone comes along and they're kicking ass, then we're sort of saying, you don't have to go back. So it just depends what it is. On the programming side, that's a bit more difficult. You really typically want people with strong math backgrounds in the programming. Other programmers. So looking at specifically more of like the A levels and stuff like that. That kind of stuff is something you get from there on the sort of programming side. But once again, we just tend to send out a programming test, and if someone scores higher in the programming test, then we'll usually make them an offer. Animation, once again, is just, if we hire a lot of people that who would be at university and have a really promising showreel, and they can show just the stuff they're doing, they just work at themselves, they just show that they're committed to do stuff in their own time to make this to show you, then that makes a big difference. It really is that sort of commitment. But there's no put it this way, if going on a computer games course at university doesn't make one iota of a difference to me in terms of the higher person. It's about a lot of other things.
I've had people in the past and I'm like, what do you want to do? Oh, I'm going to school for, game animation, so when I'm done I'm going to be a game animator. I go, no, you're going to school to learn how to animate and to learn how to use those tools. And if you really suck at it, and if you struggle with it, it may take you a long time, but just be persistent and you'll get there, right? So going to these universities, it's rare that when I look at a CV trying to fill a position or a need that we have, that I go, oh, he graduated from that school, awesome. And he goes to the top. A little bit different on some of the technical roles. If I know somebody, has gone through a master's class, their math is just crazy and they got honors, that helps inform me. But in most of those cases, like Aaron says, we'll provide tests. When it comes to design, for me it's one of the hardest ones as well in gray, and I've talked this through a lot with Pub Happy. It's more on mentality for me with the designers, right? Here's a mental problem, tell us how you would sort it out, right? Trying to get an understanding of how their head thinks. Are they thinking creatively? Are they thinking, they come back with us with questions, the objective's not clear and so on, right? And we will give people tests too, and as far as layouts, and here's a scenario and you need to build a level to get to a point. And again, is it level design, is it system design? But design, for me, it's any company, if we're hiring somebody, obviously we have a very specific need. And we, when we bring that person in, need to know, are they going to be able to fulfill that to some capacity, right? Because we're paying them. So, cool, do you have the mentality to do the work? Do you have some experience with the tools? Do you have some experience with the technology? And then hopefully we can help them grow into that role.
And then if you really want to do something which is very forgiving and demoralizing, then you want to do production. Basically, it's your job to program, make everything else work, and then get shouted at by everybody else when it's not working. And that takes a serious temperament to go through just to the back end stuff. We're fortunate to have some very good production people in the organization as well.
Yeah, I was going to say it's important to be a nice person as well, but that doesn't apply to production. Nothing's like gets your job faster than recommendations. I guess in code and maybe art you can be a little more introverted, maybe, but in design you have to run around and talk between these people. You run around talking to basically every other department, so you have to have like a face that your lead would want to be amiable and able to send out there. To keep relationships between departments.
What do you think will be the biggest challenge in Star Citizen's development over the next year?
Object code streaming going in, working. So we've got a lot of this. A lot of the stuff is months there. We need to get it working, and we have to adjust everything at the same time. You know, put all the content with the rest of you know, the Stanton system while we're doing that kind of stuff. It's a huge amount of data which we'll be plugging in and out. So that'll be, on our quality release stuff, I feel pretty good about, obviously we hit 3.1, I think we'll be fine at 3.2. 3.3 is one that worries me slightly, because if we do get the auditor streaming in and then we don't have to get everything working with it, then I can see that being a long, any of you guys from Evercati here, that could be one where you guys are having it for a while, because I think that's going to, getting that right is going to be really important. Once we get that working, then it's done. And so, as far as I'm concerned, that is the last big technical hurdle we have for Star Citizen, and then the rest of it is just basically improving the game systems and putting more content in there after that point. And yes, we've got some AI work to do, like I mentioned before, but literally, this is, for me, the big one. We are using stuff like rewriting physics stuff and stuff like that, but we already have a physics system, which can basically improve that, but that one is the big one for me. So I would say that getting that in, getting it in early enough, so we've got plenty of time to work with it for 3.3, then getting that out, so forth and things, will be the big one. But when that hurdle's crossed, hopefully in September, then we are then literally, for me, it's all downhill play, just creating stuff and improving the systems, making gameplay better, getting content, all that kind of stuff.
Personally, I mean, it's I guess for communication, but with these 3 monthly releases we do, it may be that, say, mining is right up to the end, right up to the edge of that, which doesn't really give, say, the mission team, which is us, like, time to make the mission for that, because the tech is still being built. So you might find that even though it's like the mining release, it's this kind of sandbox only version of that, and the missions come in the next batch.
Going to open it up to the floor now, so we can bring the microphone in.
I'll bring the microphone in then.
Nice questions only, please.
No shit questions.
And also the no when questions. When will be purely answered by soon, TM. If you come up to the microphone at the front here so everyone can hear.
Describe for us what you think voice communications would look like for us in the game. Ship to ship, sea to sea, that kind of stuff.
Basically the way it should be is obviously you've seen some of the tech working on building, obviously voice and facial avatar communications through, if you have a camera. So once we get this system working, the idea will be you will be able to, and it's actually one of the things we're working on this, right now to improve part of the social experience, is you will be able to communicate either with the group you define, to your friends, or you can have channels, you can just do stress signal to all, you can just talk to your own friends, you can talk to different people you want to do, and that will basically be in your cockpit, there'll be a screen, and you'll be able to see the avatar of the other player, and that screen who you're talking to. So that's a level. If you haven't got a camera, then you have that whole system work with you.
Anyone else? Yep, go ahead.
Okay, can we use the Reclaimer's mining laser as a weapon against other ships? And can we expect to see beam-style weapons in the future?
I don't want to think it's a ship question. We have no ship next year, but I'm pretty sure, yes, the anything that you can use for mining or all that kind of thing and so forth, it will actually do damage to other ships as well. So
it may not do much damage, I guess, depending on obviously not a weapon, and it may not be something that you can wave around and fire at ships flying around fast, but you have to get lucky.
But there is that, but it does, I'm pretty sure, the most competition had, it will actually do damage. Because if you walk, you die. And also for ships like that, so yes, it does do
I know the user interface right now with the ray tracing system is really well suited for VR, but is there anyone really putting any real work currently into VR anytime soon?
We will be supporting it. We have, as I said before, it comes down to the question of priorities.
Right.
And so right now, our guys are obviously working on fixing up a bunch of the systems which aren't working and then getting some of this new content in, but we 100% will be supporting VR. We are basically looking at, I'm actually going through a headcount review now with the team of where we're going through all the areas we feel we're missing, developers to work on stuff. It's one thing we put the plan together with all the gaps of where we feel like we need future teams. There's another one actually hiring the people, which takes a while, but we are basically, we do plan to have that sort of support. And I think that's something that we're, the cockpit van actually,
it all comes down to priorities on this. Not trying to come across an odd way. I know that VR is important. I know that it's technically not the easiest thing at all, to pull off. However, I have no concerns on our ability with our engineers to be able to pull it off to the highest level possible. Some of the engineers we currently have done VR stuff in the past.
And our developers as well, most importantly, we have a lot of developers who are very much into VR and want to do
it. Absolutely. So it is all just about priorities, so we have to get that, and Aaron keeps saying that foundation technically there, and then once the rest of the teams can start building out content, then we can start putting focus on other areas. But yeah, I want that single player experience in the cockpit. That's going to be rad.
Exactly. Yeah. Hey guys, I just had a real quick one about sort of the philosophy between mechanics and sort of modeling and design side of things, in terms of like recently there was the article about changing how like the fuel mechanic is going to work, and that's totally fine. But then of course, if one goes to one's hornet, there's a big thing on the side of it that says caution intake. So is there sort of plans to sort of say if we change the mechanic side of things, there's going to be like a repass over the design of the ships kind of thing, or?
I mean, we obviously will, if we do some changes, and that means that we have to make some changes to ships, we will do that. We're doing, as you probably noticed, we're bringing all the ships up to speed right now, actually. Some of the older ones have been around, so forth and things. So yes, we would make changes like that if that was deemed necessary and that kind of stuff. Now, whether it happens straight away is a different matter, but we would, as we go through, there's a lot of things we do in terms of, we want to get systems working, which we call tier zero. We get things working, and then we'll go and extend them later. We'll get more things working after that.
Cool. And thanks for coming out today.
Thank you. General, thank you very much for taking the time to see us all here today. What's the plans for being able to melt things that we've bought from the virtual store, Voyager Direct? All of us have got things that we've bought from there, which at the moment most of us can't use.
So basically, the plan is, what we need to do is get the currency working. So right now we're using Alpha UEC and doing these stuff that's just called Alpha. Mm-hmm. And so the plan is that all your UEC, we're working on getting this for free too, making the promises of whether we make it or not. But the idea would be that if you've got so many UEC, then when you start free too, that UEC will be in your bank account as part of Alpha UEC.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then you'll spend it as Alpha UEC. You won't lose the UEC because it's all out of it. So there'll be, money in the long business of that. So we'll basically take money out of the UEC. What we do is, and what the other thing we're doing is, because we're building in 3.2, we're building the whole shop system out. So all the items and weapons which you can't get anywhere but before you transfer them will actually be in game to buy. So then what we'll do is we'll melt everything.
Mm-hmm.
The UEC for that, that's what you'll have.
Yep.
You'll then get the equivalent of Alpha UEC, which you'll basically then get to spend, and then as you play the game, you can go spend it and buy these items and all this kind of stuff inside the game. But we're only going to do that when you can actually buy the items, yes. Which is what we plan to hopefully do in 3.2.
Thank you very much.
That's wonderful.
You said that very well.
With the 890 about to enter production, what the roles for it is command and control. Can you tell us anything about how that's going to look in game, if you've got any plan on it?
Oh dear.
No.
So the idea is, yes, the captain is the one who basically sets the security and over that he can override and take over the consoles and so forth and things, but also can set the can basically pass the orders to other sort of people and so forth. We have a paper design, but we haven't started implementing that properly for the larger captain ships and so forth. But that is one of the things that I've talked about before about how we want to put Champion back now to that and get that user experience so people really have that sort of flight control, you have the navigator, you have the engineer, all that kind of stuff. That is what we are, the whole 2.0 drive, get stuff working, it's that whole drive to make that experience. So, I mean, I would just love to, in the future, just watch people running around their interest, just running drills. It's like the combat, but before the inverted combat, we've got how they would run a ship on it, and so forth. And that's what we need to get working right now. The squadron, we obviously don't need a lot of that roles, it's not multiplayer and so forth. So we have the interest to be functioning and the stuff that in terms of, so right now you can use the turrets, you can power the ship and so forth. But and also once we get the all the item cost stuff in there, then the engineers have a big role as well to diverting power and controlling systems and that kind of stuff. And then the ability for people to like lock out, doors, airlocks, vent ships, some boarding, lock and stuff, it all comes with what we're doing. So that is the drive right now. One of the things we're really pushing hard on is to get that sort of gameplay to you guys.
Yeah, I was asking more about command and control for coordinating multiple ships from the...
Basically what would happen is a command and control ship would take feedback from other ships and so forth, so basically you can see what other ships are up to, and you've got to see them scan the whole picture and so forth, and then give out orders and so forth, so they can't see it. So it'll be basically one ship which basically coordinates a bunch of other ships and so forth at the back of level. But once again, that's still a paper design, that's not something that we're doing.
Will you be able to set waypoints at specific areas on a map?
Absolutely, yeah. And you'll be able to
designate targets.
That sort of functionality, you're going to start seeing the ability to do anyway, so as a player, you can be there just in your corner, and you can say, you can be able to set a waypoint and say, hey, there's something over there, check it out there, put or something, and tell your friends to go to this location and check it out as well. So we'll have that functionality. The kind of culture was the idea is a bigger ship which then uses the information that was just gathering to put it all together, and then can tell people what to do and that kind of stuff collectively. But and you, a lot of that stuff you see a lot faster in terms of being able to almost, if you want to, the 60. Create our point of interest to need to go there, so that's still something I'd like very soon.
Excellent, thank you very much.
And this next question will be the last before we have the signing.
Right, mine's actually a simple one. We can't figure out what that ship is behind you.
Signing desk at the back there, if people want to start lining up for that.